Good morning, everyone. The topic for my subject seminar is procalcitonin, and my moderator is Dr. Samaga. So, what is procalcitonin? It's a serum biomarker which helps us differentiate between bacterial and viral infection. So, it is present in the cases of bacterial infection and absent in the cases of viral infection, and it is 65 to 70% accurate to differentiate between these pathogens. How do we measure it? In nanogram per milliliter, and the value, normally the value is less than 0.05, we'll come to that. And so when we have these numeric values, this is how we interpret the likelihood of bacterial infection. So in less than 0.1 procalcitonin, it's very unlikely, and more than 0.5, it is very likely. Coming to a brief overview of procalcitonin triggers, they are basically bacterial toxins and cytokines like tumor necrosis factor alpha, interleukin 1 and interleukin 6. These bacterial toxins released by the bacterial pathogens are the ones that induce procalcitonin formation, hence identifying bacterial etiology of the infection. The cytokines that are released in viral infection like interferon gamma, they inhibit TNF alpha, hence viral infections doesn't induce procalcitonin formation. The synthesis in normal body is from thyroid neuroendocrine cells, and normally the procalcitonin is released in cleaved mature form of calcitonin. So normally in our body, procalcitonin is not found in very high numbers. Again, we'll be coming to that. And usage of this procalcitonin levels in everyday practice, it will reduce unnecessary antibiotic usage for especially for LRTIs by 25 to 50%. We'll talk about it in detail. Coming to triggers, so what are the most important, most effective triggers of procalcitonin formation or induction? So typical respiratory bacteria. So in LRTI, procalcitonin levels are very important, as they can point to the etiology of the infection. Legionella and mycobacteria also known to cause procalcitonin induction with a rise of more than 0.25 nanogram per milliliter. In no rise or rise less than 0.25 nanogram per milliliter, which is unlikely a bacterial infection, the agents are chlamydia, mycoplasma, viral infections, as we saw earlier, Lyme disease. In most of the fungal infections like aspergillosis, mucormycosis, malaria can cause a rise of 0.25 procalcitonin. So we have to keep that in mind, as they can be false triggers or causes of false positive procalcitonin. So these are the atypical triggers, more causes of false positives. In absence of infection, when there is a rise of procalcitonin, it can be due to severe physiological stress like in burns, trauma, surgery, infarct or bleed, shock. In malignancies like medullary thyroid carcinoma, lung carcinoma. So as we can see, medullary thyroid carcinoma, the cells are the C cells, the calcitonin producing cells are the ones which are malignant. That is where the procalcitonin is released from. So hence the procalcitonin will be high. It can be considered a tumor marker in medullary thyroid carcinoma. In renal efficiency, the procalcitonin baseline levels are usually high. We'll see that a little later on. So in renal insufficiency CKD patients, procalcitonin is not a very good marker of figuring out bacterial infection. In other immunological or rheumatological disorders, there is no rise in procalcitonin like gout, SLE, rheumatoid arthritis, inflammatory bowel disease, polyarthritis nodosa, and malignancies like lymphomas, sarcomas, RCCs, pancreatic carcinomas, usually we don't get a rise. And even long-term glucocorticoids, we don't see an elevated procalcitonin. Coming to synthesis of procalcitonin, in normal individuals, the procalcitonin levels, like I said, is less than 0.05 nanogram per milliliter. That is very small quantity of procalcitonin in the body. It is produced by thyroid neuroendocrine cells and it is, as we can see here, it is cleaved into the mature form of calcitonin in the endocrine cells itself before being released into the blood circulation. So basically, procalcitonin as it is not released in the blood circulation in normal circumstances. So this can be elevated, this can be triggered by elevated calcium levels, glucocorticoid usages, but it doesn't cause a significant rise in procalcitonin in normal individuals. In case of inflammation or bacterial infection, these are the triggers, like we saw, for release of procalcitonin directly into the blood circulation. In cases of inflammation, between 6 to 24 hours of infection, procalcitonin will rise and peak. So toxins, inflammatory mediators can induce any cell in the body. Normally, it is only produced in thyroid neuroendocrine cells. In cases of infection, all the cells of the body can produce procalcitonin and release into the blood circulation, hence increasing the levels. So the kinetics are as follows. The levels rise within 2 to 4 hours of stimulus, that is bacterial infection, peaks in 1 to 2 days. And peak levels correlate with the severity of function. So higher the peak levels, more severe is the infection, bacterial infection. And there is a decline by 50% every 24 to 36 hours. So we can, with procalcitonin measures, we can see whether our antibiotics are working, whether the infection is getting resolved. And like I said, it is altered in renal dysfunction. So the baseline itself of procalcitonin in renal dysfunction is very high. So bacterial infection will induce more and it will take a longer time to come down. We'll see this later. So what is the clinical use of using procalcitonin levels? Basically, it is used in guiding early antibiotic discontinuation in community-acquired pneumonia patients. So like we saw, the pathogens causing community-acquired pneumonia like streptococcus, staphylococcus and Haemophilus influenzae are the ones which cause the highest induction of procalcitonin levels. So when we serially measure them, we can see whether the antibiotic is working and whether we can stop the antibiotic early on. And it cannot be used as a measure for antibiotic initiation. And in critically ill patients, empiric therapy is anyway recommended and it should not be delayed. But whether the antibiotic should be continued for 7 days or 5 days, we can, after 5 days we can stop. It can be guided by procalcitonin levels, and that is what it is majorly used for. Procalcitonin levels can also relate to prognosis, as we can, like I said, we can monitor serial levels, which is more helpful in determining the prognosis than just a single value. Rising levels are indicative of higher mortality and adverse outcomes, and levels that fail to decline with antibiotic therapy suggest a need for re-evaluation for therapeutic approach like higher antibiotics or longer antibiotics. So this is what guides the antibiotic discontinuation in community-acquired pneumonia. We obtain procalcitonin levels every 1 to 2 days. Like we said, decline is 50% in every 1 to 1.5 days. So then we see what is the most likely diagnosis based on initial clinical features, procalcitonin levels and other test results. If it is a viral pneumonia, then procalcitonin less than 0.25 will means that there is no concurrent community-acquired pneumonia. So we can actually discontinue the antibiotics. If procalcitonin levels are higher, we have to consider the possibility of concurrent bacterial community-acquired pneumonia or a false positive procalcitonin, that is cases like shock and trauma and previous history of surgery and all those things that we discussed earlier. If it is a non-infectious cause and procalcitonin is low, so obviously the bacterial CAP is unlikely and we can discontinue the antibiotics. But if it is high, then we have to consider again bacterial CAP and any after ruling out any false positive or atypical triggers of procalcitonin. So if it's a bacterial pneumonia, then we have to see serial procalcitonin levels and how they are declining every 1 to 2 days. So if the procalcitonin level is low, we can discontinue the antibiotic if at least 5 days of they are given. If the procalcitonin level is higher than 0.25, but the peak level was more than 5 initially, then we have to see how much percentage of decline has happened in procalcitonin. If there is a more than 80% of decline, then we can discontinue the antibiotics. If not, then we can continue for a few more days and reevaluate. If the peak level was not more than 5 nanogram per milliliter of procalcitonin, then we should continue the antibiotics because the procalcitonin level is still more than 2.5. So it's very straightforward. We can just follow this flow chart. And if the procalcitonin level is not declining, then like we said, we have to reevaluate our therapeutic approach and see whether there is an alternative cause of elevation or whether we need to increase the elevate the antibiotics to treat the cause. In guiding antibiotic discontinuation, procalcitonin has been mentioned in the few guidelines which are used to treat sepsis and long-standing infection. So the 2016 surviving sepsis guidelines, which are the latest, say that measurement of procalcitonin can be used to support shortening of duration and discontinuation of antibiotics, but it is a very it has very low quality of evidence till now, so it's a very weak recommendation. The 2016 IDSA antimicrobial stewardship guidelines suggests weekly that in adults in ICUs, use of serial procalcitonin measurements can decrease, can be used to decrease the antibiotic usage. So again, it's a weak recommendation, and in ICUs, usually in critically ill patients, the antibiotic initiation should not be monitored based on PCT measurements, because empiric therapy should not be delayed. Other LRTIs, like we are living in the COVID pandemic era right now, so in COVID-19, it is seen that rise in procalcitonin levels are present with disease severity. It can be due to the systemic inflammation and not due to the viral infection itself, as we have seen that viral infection doesn't really stimulate the PCT levels, and we really can't rely on it for specific to look for a superimposed secondary bacterial infection. So it is not very reliable, but a serial rise in PCT levels can be used to correlate with disease severity. Coming to ventilator associated pneumonia, usually these are critically ill patients, so procalcitonin levels doesn't have much of a role here, and like I said, empiric antibiotics have to be started regardless of the levels. The 2016 IDSA guidelines for VAP strongly recommends that antibiotics should be started on clinical criteria alone. And the 2017 European Latin American guidelines does not recommend routine biomarker measurement to predict clinical response and adverse outcomes at 3 to 4 days. Basically, this says that in critically ill patients who acquire ventilator associated pneumonia after requiring a ventilator for a long time, procalcitonin measures should not really be used to dictate antibiotic therapy. So in acute exacerbation of COPD, infections are generally less invasive than CAP or viral infections. So the degree of PCT level correlation is really uncertain, and acute bronchitis is usually due to the viral infections, and again PCT levels are usually not induced very well. Evaluation of dyspnea. In evaluation of dyspnea, when we are uncertain and we are evaluating initially whether it's a pneumonia versus pulmonary edema in heart failure, we can use PCT to judge whether it's a bacterial infection or not, but it is really unable to narrow down any differential diagnosis. So it is not really recommended that you use PCT as a reliable marker to evaluate cause of dyspnea initially. But if you have a strong clinical suspicion of pneumonia, then whether it's a viral or a bacterial pneumonia, we can go back to that flowchart and use our clinical judgment to discontinue or shorten the duration of antibiotic therapy. Again, I would like to stress that procalcitonin is not used for initiation of antibiotic therapy. So what are the limitations of using procalcitonin levels? There are a lot of false positives, like atypical triggers, especially in critically ill patients, like systemic inflammation, shock, trauma, surgery, as we saw. And there are a lot of false negatives also, like in localized infections, or if procalcitonin levels are measured too early in the course of infection. As we said, single value is less reliable than serial measurements of procalcitonin. In chronic kidney disease, baseline levels of procalcitonin are higher. So there is, because usually there are higher levels of circulating inflammatory cytokines, so the procalcitonin baseline levels usually remain elevated. They do drop with the patients on who are on maintenance hemodialysis by 20 to 80%, but it is uncertain of what the baseline becomes. And the rate of rise in infection is slower in CKD patients than in healthier patients, and elimination is also slightly prolonged, so the decline levels are also slower, hence making procalcitonin levels very unreliable to guide antibiotic therapies. Also, in immunocompromised patients, the baseline levels of procalcitonin are usually higher. This is due to the fact that there are concurrent causes which cause systemic inflammation, and the PCT levels are chronically induced, and hence baseline becoming higher. And it is not recommended to use it as a guideline to discontinue antibiotics, since there is higher morbidity from bacterial infection, and which requires a longer duration of antibiotics. This brings us to the end. Thank you very much.